this was the pale blue dot. This was our willingness to see the Earth as a one pixel object in a far greater cosmos. It's that humility that science gives us, that weans us from our childhood need to be the center of things. And Voyager gave us that image of the Earth that is so heart-tugging, because it's, you can't look at that image and not think of how fragile our world is, how much we have in common with everyone with whom we share it, our relationship, our relatedness to everyone on this tiny pixel.
I feel like I'm leaving the planet again. That's a powerful video, right? When you see the dot, the pale blue dot, and then you imagine that in the vastness of the universe, here we are, in a unique time and place, uniquely provisioned in life, in unique circumstances. And this morning we gather as the body of Christ in this local assembly and worship the Lord who created all that. That's a little bit about what I want to do today. I really want to take you to a vantage point, what you see on the screen there, and view that pale blue dot, and maybe give you a vicariously unique perspective of, as the psalmist says, the work of his hands, the work of his hands in creation, and how he ordered his creation in detail that we just have a glimpse of. We have yet to even begin, I think, to comprehend, define, to utilize the provision that he has placed uniquely and with all wisdom into his creation, and then relinquished it to us, humanity, uniquely gifted with the image of God, and given abilities that we... frankly, are fascinated with, just as we watch what goes on with technology development. Even in recent years, the smartphone that's in our pocket or our pocketbook, and just imagining what that capability is and what it means, even compared to 10, 15, 20 years ago, any acceleration of that. It gives testimony to two things, and I want to try to illustrate that in a new, unique way today. It gives testimony to God's wisdom in his creation, the precision in his ordering of his creation, and the vastness of the provision that he placed in his creation. And then coupled with that is the ability he uniquely gave humanity, mankind, who bear his image. I want to remind you that as we see the photography and study the Earth, get a glimpse of it, if you will, this morning through the photography from this vantage point of low Earth orbit, that even our response to it is something worthy to note. Why do we even care? What about it draws our attention? Why do we feel appreciation? Why do we feel awe and wonder? All of that, why are we interested in it? All of that, and our ability to then go further and to find things in his creation and to develop them gives us understanding through the lens of Scripture, a biblical worldview of all of history, in that we bear the image of God. And his unique creation, specifically our home that we call Earth, that pale blue dot, that's in our view here, that's filling the window in our, from our vantage point, invokes awe and wonder of who he is. It's a reflection of the Creator, and it reminds us of our unique place, each of us uniquely placed in time and space, and by his grace called into the body of Christ, in which we assemble today to worship him. I want to vicariously take you to the vantage point of Earth orbit. The next slide here is the International Space Station. Who here has seen the space station fly over with the naked eye? A few of you. This is your homework assignment. You can search the internet. You can get an app for your phone. Just search ISS sightings or something like that, and you'll find a tool that will allow you to find the times when you can look into the sky if it's a clear either evening or morning and watch the International Space Station fly overhead. It's brighter than anything in the night sky except for the moon. It's actually an incredible sight when you have maybe researched to see what's going on board right now, and you realize that there are usually six people, a crew of six on board. I've been there, as was mentioned, four times over the last 20 years, first time in 2000. It has an amazing story of itself, one in which I don't have time to go into today, but just the story of the International Space Station is amazing. And actually, it's a modern example of what I'm talking about, taking the provision of God, the ordering of his creation, and mankind's ability to exploit it, to use it, to develop it, to develop engineering and technology, and then put it to use. That's a modern example of that, that illustrates those principles, those transcendent truths that we're going to touch on this morning. The space station was built from 1998 to 2011 when we completed the assembly. Many launches of the space shuttle, 37 were dedicated to the space station. There were an equivalent number of Russian rocket launches dedicated to its assembly. So, and again, that's another story for another day, but an amazing story in itself. It continues to fly. I was there last landing a little less than 3.5 years ago. It's in its full operational mode right now. We've had continuous human presence in space, for now into our 20th year. Next fall will be 20 years. And many people don't realize that, that we are active in space exploration. The space station is a very good platform from which to view and study the Earth and the surface of the Earth. If you can imagine the globe, in the equator of the Earth, the orbit of the space station is inclined to the equator 51.6 degrees. That means we cross the equator, go up to 51.6 degrees north latitude, cross the equator again, come down 51.6 south, come back, cross the equator. We do that every 90 minutes. It takes 90 minutes to go around the Earth going 17,500 miles an hour. If you can imagine the Earth rotating under us once every 24 hours, each time we cross the equator about 1,500 miles to the west of the previous crossing. That means that over each and every day and over weeks and months, you can study the entire planet with the exception of the North and South Pole in different lighting conditions with different sun angles, day and night. And over weeks and months, you watch seasons go by. You watch the snow cover drift south in the wintertime in the northern hemisphere, and then the spring melt drift north. You watch brown fields turn green. So it's a great vantage point. 90 minutes in every orbit means that you see a sunrise and a sunset every orbit as well, which are spectacular, and I'm going to show you a couple pictures of that in a few minutes. The next slide is the space station on the night side of the Earth. And I show this view just to give you an appreciation for the, you see the diameter of the sphere of the Earth there in the background, and you see that bluish white arc. That is the atmosphere, and the sun is just over the atmosphere, or just going over the horizon, rather, and backlitting the atmosphere. And it gives you a relative or a perspective of the relative size of the atmosphere relative to the diameter of the Earth. And the atmosphere, of course, we know very well. We don't maybe think of it this way, but the atmosphere, the water cycle, all of it contains, and the dynamic aspects of it are part of the life support system that God created so that the Earth is habitable, and then he inhabited it, and we are in its habitation. By the way, we have to duplicate all of those processes that are found in God's creation up on the space station. We have to maintain our oxygen. We have to remove the carbon dioxide. We have to remove the humidity. And it's very complex. It's not that reliable. We have redundant systems. They fail once in a while. We repair them. And even that gives you an appreciation of the wonder of God's work in creation as he provisioned it and ordered it. The next slide here is a view out the window during the daytime, and what you see there is structure of the space station. You can see right of center a Russian spacecraft that is a Soyuz, it's called, and that's what we launch from in Kazakhstan and then return to Earth and landing it also in Kazakhstan. And my first flight was on the space shuttle. My last three flights were on a Russian Soyuz, so I've spent a lot of time over there. That's another story for another day. Is our participation with our international partners, which include not only Russia, but Japan, the European Space Agency, which is made up of about 12 countries, and Canada. It's an amazing partnership. The space station, even in that respect, in the geopolitical sense, is a great story to tell. The next slide shows the view out the window at night. If you turn all the lights off on the inside, the star field outside is amazing. And it calls to mind the obvious scripture passages like Psalm 8 and Psalm 19. The Milky Way is as if it's painted in the sky as a backdrop to the brighter stars that are spread across the front of the Milky Way. Just an incredible view. And you never get tired of looking out the window and studying the detail of either deep space or the surface of the Earth. The next slide is an example of a sunset that I mentioned earlier. They happen twice every 90 minutes, sunrise and then a sunset. This is an example of the sun just as it starts going over the horizon, and you see the vivid oranges, yellows, blues, and whites. The next slide is a close-up of a sunset. You just see the sliver of bright white there. That is the edge of the sun as it goes across the horizon. The oranges are the lower parts of the atmosphere, and the black pattern in the orange are cloud formations that actually form shadows in the foreground of the sun. So the sun is shining from behind, shining through the atmosphere. That's the bright orange, the lower layers of the atmosphere. And then the black, of course, is caused by shadows of thick clouds where the sun doesn't shine through it. And then above that, you see a varying colors, which don't show up too well in this picture, but the next picture, they do show up. And you can see the different layers of the atmosphere. So again, the oranges and the blacks in the bottom where the weather is. And then above the weather system, you have the different layers of the atmosphere here showing up in the whites and the silvers and the blues. Just an incredible perspective. This one taken through about an 800 millimeter lens. The next slide is a very unique, an example of some of the unique phenomena that you can see from the vantage point. I was not aware of this until I got to orbit the first time and happened to see them. They're called noctilucent clouds. You can search for information on them to read about them yourselves. They are typically seen over the North Pole in the middle of our summertime and over the South Pole in the middle of our wintertime, or the summertime in the southern hemisphere. Noctilucent clouds, they're well above the standard weather systems that we see when we look out the window and see clouds, on the order of 80 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The theory is that they're formed by ice crystals that are transported up there by the jet stream and the different air currents. And then you see different layers of the atmosphere here that form different patterns. A very unique pattern, very mysterious, very beautiful in its own sense, not fully understood. So it gives us an example of a glimpse of God's work just slightly beyond our reach, in a sense, in a figurative and a literal sense. Noctilucent clouds just invokes awe and wonder. By the way, when we attribute beauty to something, when we use words like awe and wonder, if you go back, and they're all over the Psalms and elsewhere in the Old Testament, and if you go back to the Hebrew to look at those words require God as their explanation. They require God as its explanation. And us, it gives a testimony of us bearing the image of God. We respond that way because of Him who created all things and ordered and provisioned all things for us. The next slide is one of my favorite slides. We won't go there for sake of time, but Job 26 has a verse that is written from the perspective of off the planet. And it says, He has drawn a line between the light and darkness on the surface of the water. That's a paraphrase in the middle of Job 26. But it's written from the perspective of off the planet. This is it. When you look out the window and you see this, you can see a line that separates the lit part of the earth from the dark part of the earth, and it forms a line. We call it the Terminator. That's our technical term. It is recorded observing it in Job 26, the oldest book of the Bible, older than the books of Moses, the first five books of the Bible. An incredible testimony to the inspiration of Scripture, that it is the Word of God, the Creator of all things. You never get tired of studying the details of the surface of the earth. And the next slide is first of several I have here of some of the phenomena that you can see and study on the surface through a bigger lens. This one through an 800 millimeter lens. This is a glacier in northern Pakistan, one of my favorite pictures of a vast collection that I have of glaciers from around the world. Unique in its pattern as it winds its way through the valleys of the mountains in northern Pakistan, carrying the ice, the accumulated snowfall, and the ice and the soil and rocks downhill over a period of time. The next slide is another great example of a glacier. This one is in Patagonia, in the southern tip of South America. The Patagonia ice shelves, have many beautiful glaciers. This is one of them. Again, unique in pattern. We would ascribe beauty to them, both in color and pattern, and just uniqueness of the visual effects of it. By the way, we know what's pleasing to the eye, right? And we know what's boring or not pleasing to the eye. We also know what's pleasing to the ear. We hear music and it's pleasing to us, right? And we know what harmony is. We also know what dissonance is. It's not pleasing. It grates us. It causes us pain. Even that is a testimony to, one, God's creation, but a fallen creation. And us bearing the image of God. And we know good and evil. We know the differences between good and evil. We also know the differences between order and disorder. And that just gives us a glimpse of that as well and helps inform our understanding, giving us a biblical worldview of God's works and our living in them. We also have that glimpse of the consequences of the fall in that. Next slide. There's another example of a beautiful phenomenon on the surface of the earth. This is perhaps the most photographed river delta in the world. It's on the island of Madagascar off the continent of Africa. It's unique in its pattern and its shapes and the tributaries that form this final delta before it goes into the Indian Ocean. Unique in color because of the soils that are carried down from upstream. It catches your eye visually just looking out the window primarily because of the color. And then you look and you see the pattern of the delta, so that hence it becomes the most photographed river delta in the world by astronauts and cosmonauts. Next slide is a wide-angle view looking up the spine of South America. You see the Andes Mountains there in South America, looking north, and the Pacific ocean is on the left side with all the weather, the cloud formations over the Pacific. Next slide. How many here have been to the Grand Canyon? Quite a few of you, a lot of you. Folks ask me all the time, is there anything on the planet that compares to the view from up there? And one example I like to give is the Grand Canyon. I was there 30 years ago or 35 years ago or so, and it invokes this sense of awe and wonder, right? And the scale of it is grand to us when we, for example, stand on the South Rim and see it, both in its vastness and its beauty, in the demonstrated power that it shows, that formed it. This is what the Grand Canyon looks like from orbit. It's like a scar out of the Earth's surface in the middle of that high desert there in Arizona and Utah. The next slide is an oblique view of the same Grand Canyon, this time right after a snowfall. As I recall, this was in December of 2009. It's just as beautiful from up there as it is, of course, on the ground. Next slide. Mount St. Helens, some of you perhaps have been there in Washington State. And a great example of the power and energy that is present in the earth, in God's creation. Of course, we remember that in May 1980, half the mountain blew its side. Of course, that was a big worldwide event that occurred. People died in the explosion. It was very explosive. Lots of things happened very quickly. It actually now, not that many years later, just a few decades later, again, 1980, it's a great place to study and compare with the other effects that we see around the world, Grand Canyon included, that would be, we would attribute to as the result of the biblical flood in early chapters of Genesis. So it gives testimony to that. So Mount St. Helens is a very unique place from our vantage point as well as on the ground. Next slide. This is a volcano eruption in the Aleutian Islands. Off the coast of Alaska. It was May of 2006. On that flight, we were a crew of two, my Russian crewmate and I. And we were 6 weeks into our 6 month stay. I was kind of having a down day. You know, we all have down days, even up there as an astronaut. You can have a down day with feeling of isolation, knowing that the family's home. My wife and I talk every day on the phone when I'm up there, usually at least twice a day. So we had talked that day. In the middle of the morning, I'd gone back to the back end of the space station, have a bag of tea with Pavel, my crewmate. We don't drink cups of tea. We drink it through a straw because of the weightless environment. But that was our habit, take a break, have a tea and chat a little bit. And when I got done drinking tea, I started floating back to the front end of the station, floated over the window, looked out the window, noticed this island popping through the clouds, recognized it as one of the Aleutians, grabbed the camera as was my habit, pointed it, started taking pictures of one island, then the next island, then the next island. Something in the back of my head said, that last one didn't look right. I went back and reframed it, and it was this. It's a volcano called Cleveland. I had the opportunity to take two or three frames, was all, and then it was out of view. And I got all excited. I went up and got on the communication system, called Houston and at Mission Control, and said, hey, I just saw this volcano erupting. And I was all excited about it. And I could see the entire plume, so the eruption had just started. And just reported it, told them I had pictures, and they could downlink the pictures. Of course, that got me pretty excited. It was out of view. I knew that we're orbiting every 90 minutes, and 90 minutes later, we were going to come back and see it again. So I was going to be back in the window to take more pictures of it. So the next slide shows the next orbit. The eruption was done. The cloud had detached from the volcano, was blowing downwind. You could see the fresh lava down the side of the volcano. In the meantime, I had called... the CAPCOM down in Mission Control searched the internet, found the Alaskan Volcano Observatory, looked it up, got a phone number, called them up and said, hey, this is Steve Bowen is his name. I'm the CAPCOM and Mission Control down at NASA in Houston, and we just got a report from the International Space Station that one of your volcanoes is erupting. And there was a hesitation on the other end, and he told me later, he said, yeah, they thought it was a prank call. Sure. Sure. And he tried to assure them, no, it really was from Mission Control, and the report was real. Well, he got her the name of the scientist and the phone number up to me, so I called her up and said, hey, this is Jeff Williams on the space station. I heard you got the report already. I'm just following up to see if you got the pictures of your erupting volcano. Of course, there's another hesitation. This is just accelerating the prank, right? And I could tell she wasn't going to buy into it completely, but when you got a call from the station in those days, especially, there was a delay in the transmission, and it was just a uniqueness in that. So certainly there was a lot of doubt. She didn't want to fully buy into it. But eventually we got through that, and actually after the flight, we had a great conversation about the whole thing. So it made a big hit up there. Of course, it made a big hit with me. It brought me out of my slump. And if my wife was here, she would want me to make sure that I said the punchline, the bottom line. She was praying that day specifically that the Lord would bring something into my day that would lift me out of my slump. We just had no idea it was going to be a volcano eruption. To this day, I'm the only person that I know of on or off the planet that saw that particular eruption. So, and it's a reminder that we, as believers in Jesus Christ, have a duty, as we was reflected in the psalm, to study his works, but also to look for his works in the details of our lives, because he orders all things in each of our lives. And if we look for them, we see them, even in the hard times, even in the tough days, even when the periods of hopelessness, he's working through that for our good, right? That's what Paul writes in Romans chapter 8. And it grows our appreciation of that. It grows our transcending hope, the transcending nature of a hope that looks beyond the circumstances of life. And it grows our sense of gratitude and thanksgiving to the one who has given us life and then given us eternal life through Christ Jesus. Moving on, another example of the great phenomena you can see in the surface of the earth are coral reefs. And this is a wide angle shot looking to the north, and then just left of center in the upper part of the globe there, you can make out the peninsula of Florida, and perhaps you can see the arc of the Keys coming off the southern tip. The island in the foreground is the island of Cuba. Right of center, all the turquoise blue pattern, that's the Bahamas. If you've been down there, the most beautiful coral reefs that I have seen off the planet, on the planet, is in the Bahamas. The next slide is looking straight down at the Florida Keys, and some of you have perhaps been there. Another unique example of the beauty in God's creation and reflectively our appreciation of beauty. And this is what it's like looking straight down. The next slide is a wide angle of the Bahamas themselves and all the array of coral reefs. The next slide is a close-up of the largest reef in the Bahamas. It doesn't look real when you look at it. It looks like it should be a watercolor painting hanging in a museum someplace. But this is what it looks like out the window. And just unique in color, unique in pattern, unique in order, a mathematical order where you see a repeating pattern, which is testimony to the order in God's creation. Next slide is a part of the outback of Australia. Australia is a very unique continent. It is unique among all portions of the Earth's surface. It looks like another planet in some respects. And these are mostly dry lake beds in a very desert type area in the middle of the outback in Western Australia. The next slide is an example of some dynamic events you can see from our vantage point. This is a hurricane off the Atlantic, the East Coast in the Atlantic. And this one did not make landfall. I can't remember the name of it, but an example of the incredible power that creation contains. Also a reminder of the utter destruction that can still be or that we can realize. I mean, we've gone through hurricanes, you've gone through storms up here that can come from the fallen creation. Next slide is an example of a dynamic event. Here we go. There a fire, a large fire in Southern California. The lower right-hand corner is Edwards Air Force Base in the Mojave Desert, just to orient you. So north of Los Angeles, a big fire. Next slide. Sand dunes. Next slide. There's some sand dunes in the Sahara. Beautiful in their own right. The next slide is another set of sand dunes, again, given the mathematical order in God's creation. This one's very geometric. You see orthogonal lines crossing there. You see large scale and small scale repeating patterns, if you will, which is a demonstration of a mathematical order. If you're not a mathematician, perhaps you like music. Music is another clear demonstration of the mathematical order and precision that God put in his creation. Next slide, example of provision. Here's some lumber operations up in the Pacific Northwest, state of Washington or Oregon, and I think these are square miles of logging operations. Next slide reminds us that everything that we eat comes from God's creation. We grow it out of the ground, we raise animals for meat. These are grain fields north of Paris for food. Next slide are different agricultural fields to include grain, and the yellow is rapeseed from which, among other things, canola oil is produced, and we probably all have it in our kitchens. Next slide is another example of provision in God's creation. Here's an open pit mine in northern Mexico. The next slide is an open pit coal mine in Central Europe. The next slide is salt ponds in western China, from which different chemicals are produced that are used in different applications and technology and engineering development. The next slide is a wide-angle lens, again, looking up to the north across a Central Valley there, just left of center in California, which, of course, is known as the breadbasket of America, right, where so much food that we have in our grocery stores is produced. Again, a visual testimony of the provision that God put in his creation and our ability to extract it. Next slide. If you wanted to consider the whole world history of civilization and the economic system and mankind's ability to subdue and have dominion over the creation as was mandated in Genesis 1, here's one of those places in the earth that symbolizes a lot of that. New York City, Manhattan, Central Park, you might recognize there. So it's a very visual illustration of mankind, humanity's ability to do all these things we've been talking about. The next slide is one of my favorite views from orbit. Your pastors, two of your pastors and others are there right now. In the Middle East, in the Holy Land, in Israel. And from our vantage point, in this view, we can see the entire biblical history from the call of Abraham to the incarnation of the Son of God, Jesus Christ, his life, his journey to the cross, place of his resurrection, where his final appearances were made. And then, of course, the apostles as they sent out the gospel message to the world to include the missionary journeys of Paul. We see that entire thing from our vantage point here. And seeing it through the lens of Scripture gives it so much more meaning, right? I've touched on these themes as I've talked about it, reminding you of God's unique creation and how he provisioned his creation and how he ordered it. With precision, by the way, that's what makes engineering possible. That's why we can launch a rocket and know precisely what time we need to launch it to 2 days later rendezvous with a space station going 17,500 miles an hour and then dock to it going 0.1 feet per second plus or minus a couple of inches. Because we have the ability to do that. Mathematically, we can predict it. And that's just one illustration of endless things that we can do. But the Bible reminds us, and we know, that even with all our abilities, given what God has given us by common grace, there's something out of our reach. There's something that's unattainable. The Bible calls it wisdom, and it means true wisdom. And we're familiar with those verses out of Proverbs and Job and elsewhere that that say the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Wisdom is, as the Bible describes it, is unattainable. We cannot achieve it. We cannot reach it. We know it's there, Job would tell us, but we cannot attain it. It has to be granted to us. It has to be granted to us by grace. The wisdom of God has to be granted to us by God. And he has disclosed himself in creation, and he has uniquely disclosed himself, revealed himself in redemption, the work of redemption, which is a Trinitarian work, both creation and redemption, manifested in the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, who we confess each and every week as we gather together in corporate worship, who has created all things, sustains his creation, has given us unique provision in all things, and ultimately by grace, not by our achievement or our merit or our worth or anything with us, completely by grace, also redeemed us through that Trinitarian work disclosed in the Son of God. Perhaps the best, one of the best places to illustrate that, to kind of summarize that big view of what we've seen, comes from Paul's writing his letter to the Colossians, chapter 1, starting with verse 15. He's speaking of Jesus Christ, and he says, he, Christ, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, that is, he is eternal. He is eternal God. And in him all things hold together. That is, he not only created all things, but he sustains, he upholds his creation. If he withdrew his power, creation would cease to exist. So he's active in sustaining and holding together his creation. Paul goes on, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of the cross. So here in these very short verses, Paul ties the reality of the biblical worldview of the creator of all things as a consequence of the fall by grace also redeems all things. And our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the creator, also by grace granted us the gift of faith to trust in him and his works on the cross, to bring him back and bring us back into relationship with him, and by his work we are saved. It's an incredible story. And by the way, we want to not discount his creative work. If I know I'm borrowing a little bit of your time here, but I want to make the point that oftentimes we discount the record of creation and his creative work in the early chapters of Genesis, in which are echoed throughout the scriptures all the way to Revelation. But if we have doubts in creation, in the way he created all things, but yet we confess the New Testament, we confess Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, then I would have to ask the question, you believe parts of the Bible, but you don't believe the beginning of the Bible, then where in the Bible do you begin to believe it? God has revealed himself in so many ways. He's revealed himself in creation, and he's revealed himself in his word. We are to trust his word from his creation to his redemption with this hope over the horizon in eternity. We know that our lives are but a vapor, but a short period of time in time and place that God has uniquely put each of us. But we have this eternal hope over the horizon in eternity where we will be in fellowship with the Father because of access of Jesus Christ. This next slide here is invokes awe and wonder in its own right. It's Aurora looking out the window of the station. I'm going to show a 3-minute video, take you a little bit over your time. Lunch is getting cold, I know, but we'll be out of here shortly. This is a 3-minute video that best, I think, illustrates for us visually these things that we've been talking about as we contemplate the work of our triune God, Father, Son, and Spirit. So let's roll the video. Don't we have an amazing God? Dear Heavenly Father, you are amazing. Your work is amazing, Lord. May we grow in our appreciation of it for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.